Hey everyone, welcome to the Underdog Dentist Show. I am Dr. Girish Likhiani, and we are here to talk about how to decide the treatment charges in these troubled times. We are calling it Finance and Investment Sundays, and we'll be taking this over a period of time. We'll be covering it on all the four Sundays of this month. So today's topic will be about how to decide treatment charges, and Dr. Bhavdeep Singh Ahuja, he's going to help us and guide us through the process. Let me introduce Dr. Bhavdeep Singh Ahuja first. He's a renowned practitioner at Ludhiana with 21 years of clinical experience. He is an alumnus of Punjabi University, Patiala. Dr. Bhavdeep holds a triple MBA in hospital management, finance, and HR and marketing. He also holds a PG diploma in medical law and ethics from the National Law University. He has more than 75 original scientific publications to his credit and lectures extensively on the topics of practice management, medical laws and ethics, consent, and finance for dentists. He is well known for his clinical approach and exhaustive lectures. His last webinar with the Underdog Dentist squad took over somewhere around 15,000 views and attracted questions from freshers and seasoned practitioners. It was well appreciated by everyone and shared across all the platforms on social media, including YouTube and Facebook. Dr. Bhavdeep, you are welcome, and over to you. Please continue with the topic, and thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Dr. Girish and Dr. Vaibhav from the Underdog Dentist Squad. It is my proud privilege to be here on the four Sundays of June with you guys. Thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity. I would like to, of course, devote my attention to the basics in the finance field. Obviously, if we talk of the treatment charges, it is a line which I'll say, which is an overlapping thing between the practice management and the finance part. And vaguely speaking, if we say that most of us, or we were made to opt, or we opted for medical in the 10 plus 1 because of the fear of maths, for most of us, not if all, for most of us. But then COVID times have made us say, go back to pick up the 10th standard maths book again. And I'll try to simplify those things today. Why my presentation? I'll be sticking to a presentation of around 1 hour or so, plus minus 10 minutes. After that, we'll be taking up the queries. So both Dr. Girish and Dr. Vaibhav are there to assist me. So I'm going to share my screen now so that my presentation can begin. Dr. Girish, I'm not able to share my screen.
Yes, sir, please do it now.
Okay. Is the screen visible now?
Yes, sir, it is visible now.
Okay. Let's, without much ado, we all try to be punctual in our lives. So this is part one of the finance presentation with the Underdog Dentist Squad. So all my presentations always begin with the thanking finance presentations, especially begin with thanking my dad who left us last year in the month of June. Without his guidance, I would have been nothing. Of course, I have my MBA finance also, but then what influence he had in say inculcating finance or the even the basic or the advanced level onto me is absolutely totally his contribution, and which I can never forget. Of course, the thanks is due to the Lord Almighty as well, who has given me much more than what I deserve. So this is my brief biodata. Girish already told you about it. So let's start. So we are all here for the first Sunday of the June. We'll be discussing about the treatment charges part today. So I always say in my finance lectures, they always start with this first line, this practice management without the knowledge of finance is a big zero. So we all know that the scenario in the post-COVID times is changing now. the numbers and figures are much more important than what they were before. Unless you have a good knowledge of your numbers, I'm not sure whether we'll be able to say deal with those scenarios which are gonna say attract us, because the income is not going to be the same. Definitely the costs are going to increase. They have already increased even before we started practicing properly, or say just even the consultation part. So if we we have to be prepared for the challenges of costing in this post-COVID-19 era. So whenever our full working resumes, so before that also, we know that there are many things which will be affecting us. The oral healthcare services are all set to see a big rise in the costs, the input cost, if we call it. So it is time to say reboot and reset our clinics for economics. So I'll just begin with a small challenge, if I may say so. So let's assume we are starting our AGPs or the aerosol generating procedures, maybe 1 month, maybe 2 months, maybe next week, whenever the government gives us the full clearance. We, as yet now, legally speaking, after 31st May, there have been no guidelines. Colleagues have been jumping onto these treatments, but of course, apart from the legal part and the health care part, it is not as such openly advised, or the guideline has been given by the government to start the AGPs. So whatever the CDC guidelines may say, they are not applicable on us, lawfully speaking, not otherwise, but lawfully speaking. So just assume a scenario, you're using your PPE kit and your basic armamentarium, whatever it is. We'll discuss at the end whatever armamentarium we have to buy or not buy. So let's say you were charging rupees 1,000 for a filling before. So what will you do now? Let's suppose you are doing a 400 dentistry. Your assistant and you are both wearing a PPE kit, a decent PPE kit, along with shoe cover, head cover, whatever, double gloves, N95, face shield, whatever you can think, along with your, let's suppose the HEPA filters become a necessity. They have been advised by the IES as yet, but not as such. The Government of India has not issued any guideline on any kind of gadget so far. So whosoever is jumping into the buying of such equipment may do so at their own peril. Yes, they may become a necessity, but as of now, there has been no guideline, because whenever a guideline will come from a government regarding the buying, what I believe there would always be some necessitated specifications along with it, that what, how much. And then when such a thing comes around, say registered dentists in India, 270,000, or roughly we can say 3 lakh plus dentists are registered in India. So for them, when a thing becomes mandatory in those aspects, then there will be a price tab also, just like the government put up the one on N95s also very recently, last week only. So let's suppose you are doing a procedure of 1,000 rupees at the cost of your basic equipment, PPE and your masks and your face shields and everything. And what do you do? If you just add the basic input cost of the two, necessary equipment, and you don't add any other cost of sanitizer or any other equipment, machine. Of course, equipments are not to be added as a cost. We'll be discussing in the second part about what are our costs in a clinic. The materials or the consumables, they come in the consumable parts. But whatever equipment we buy, which are the fixed assets kind of a thing, they are always, a portion of their cost is taken. So most of the dental gadgets, as I've earlier told also in my earlier sessions with the UDS, on their Underdog Dentist Squad, that a portion of the same is calculated. And that is known as a depreciation part, the written down value, or the WDV as we call it. So most of the dental equipment come with a 15% of written down value. So what does that mean? What does that mean is that, let's suppose equipment you buy is for 10,000. Of course, nothing is available for 10,000, but let's suppose for the purpose of simplification. So you will add 1,500 as your cost for the whole year, if you buy it before 2nd or 3rd of October. Why I say 2nd or 3rd of October? Because for the depreciation to come fully into effect, you have to buy before 180 days remaining of the year. And 185 days of the year elapse by 3rd October. So what I mean is, if you buy after 3rd October, you have to put in half depreciation for that year. So if you buy after 3rd October, you'll be putting a depreciation of 750 for that year, if I were to just simplify out of 10,000. So the moral of the story is that for the equipments, we will be adding a cost of their written down value for the year. Let's suppose we are just into the June, and most likely, of course, I wish and presume also that we'll be starting our AGPs well before October, say the start of October. So we'll be buying those things as per the government guidelines and specifications as and when they come in written for us before that. So we'll be buying those and we'll be adding those costs. So that is where the problem or the say calculation starts, when you have the numbers of the cost in your hand. When you know the cost, then only say you can go in for the raise part. Here we are just presuming that on an average, what I have calculated with my formula, I'll be giving you that in the later part of the presentation. So what exactly we have to do? So coming back to the existing example, which is there on the slide before you, that if you were charging 1,000 for the restoration, you add the basic, the PPE cost or the other mask and the other things cost. And let's say roughly it is 1,000 per head. And you're doing 400 dentistry, or you and your assistant. And then you add that to the basic cost. Will you charge a 3,000 for a filling? Would it be feasible and practical? But then you have to make a certain decision about it. Our topics for today also justify this, that which services we have to increase and which not. We'll be coming to a formula with that. So the escalating cost of healthcare usually leads to an inverse care law. So what is an inverse care law? Actually, it is a pun intended. It is a joke on the inverse square law of physics, which is the, say, law of electrostatics, in which the, say, radiation or any kind of energy is inversely proportional to the distance part. So it is a pun intended on that, given by Mr. Hart in 1971. He said, if the good medical care serves those who really need it, then medical equipment will not be, say, that expensive, or the medical services will not be that expensive. So, as I said, it is a pun on inverse square law. So healthcare becomes a commodity if it becomes disturbed, is like a commodity, it becomes distributed just like a champagne. So that is where rich people will get lots of it and poor people don't get any of it. So Mr. Hart said this thing, inequality in healthcare is the worst inequality of all. Because you know that you'll die sooner because you're badly off it. So how do we decide our charges based on the value? The first question comes to that part only. So calculation and management of these costs, how we do that is one thing which we have to understand in today's times. So yes, earlier dental clinics used to start, even the medical clinics today start with the not so high for structure, but the dental clinics ought to be really, say, well decked up in today's times to start that. So the starting cost also goes up. Those who had just opened are the worst hit guys, because they have already invested so much and they'll have to make changes accordingly in their new setups, according to whatever guidelines we finally settle up. So those who are in the process of opening up their clinics, they'll are still on the better side. And the ones who have medium to, say, good spaced operatories or say clinic size, they'll find it easier to adjust than the ones which are just in a very small sized areas. So they'll be the ones which will be the worst hit part. So we have to, as I said, we have to know how to calculate these costs, because once we do that, we can be on our road to success. So what is what are the four most common reasons we don't take, time to determine the percentage of clinics, overheads or costs or expenses? So we always, this is a common problem whenever we want to settle any equation about charging, we just look at the direct cost. Let's suppose mera 200 ka composite laga, just consume 200 of composite and bond. And so if I charge 500, I'm earning 300 out of it. We forget the overhead, we forget the staff salaries, we forget the bills part. So we just look at the direct cost, which is our biggest mistake. Because if you are just looking at the direct cost, where will the other cost, who will be paying for the other cost? And then we crib that dentistry is not a lucrative field. It is for us to think that we have to make it lucrative ourselves. So what are the most common reasons? The common Indian habit of main kal karunga, procrastination, or main agle Sunday se karunga. Wo agla Sunday kabhi nahi aata hai. Remember that. We're just too lazy to do it. We hate maths. We don't have the acumen to calculate the same. And then the fourth most common reason applicable to all of us, we are simply too busy to invest time. So as they said in a recent WhatsApp joke, that agar aap in chuttiyon mein, lockdown ki chuttiyon mein nahi kuch kar paaye, to aapke paas time ki kabhi bhi kami nahi thi, aapke paas attitude ki kami thi. So that is what matters. So after calculating monthly costs, many dentists will have to lower their useless expenses, because we all know that the costs are going to increase. You cannot work on same costs, because if we do that, we'll be eating up into our own carry home income. Let's suppose you have inculcated ki itna to mere ko ghar leke jana hi hai at the end of the month. I've given those examples in my say scenarios coming up in the later part. So the commonest business principle is to decrease the overhead, decrease the useless costs. So what will most of the common people will do in such a case? Common principle will say, increase the production of working, like a factory, increase the number of hours. Many of us miscalculate this thing. Just by sitting for more hours at the clinic, you are not doing any good to yourself. You're cutting on your own personal time. Maybe can be exercise time, can be your me time, can be your gym time, can be your leisure time. Of course, if not any of these, it'll surely be the family time. So you are cutting down on something by increasing on that. You're improving scheduling, or maybe increasing the selling price. So the commonest principle to decrease these, either of these three, are followed. So are they good principles to follow? No. Because they increase the perception that you have to work hard. Yes, you have to. Hard work has no substitute. But working hard like a donkey or a donkey will not serve any purpose as well. Totally defies the purpose or say the logic of Pareto principle. Most of you must be aware of what is Pareto principle. But I'll still in two, three slides give you a short description about what exactly is the Pareto principle all about. Because that is the basis of increasing my charges as well. So many of you or some of you might not be familiar with the concept. So in short, I'll be just explaining you about it. So what exactly is Pareto principle? So Pareto principle says that 80-20 rule exists in our practice. It applies to most of the businesses or say any industries. It says 80% of income will come from 20% of your clients. And the 20% of income will come from the 80% of your clients. What it roughly means is that, let's suppose you are earning or grossing means over the top, over the counter, or total collection, if I may say so, not the net carry home income. If you're grossing 1 lakh rupees a month and having 100 patients, I'm just taking the round figures for simplification, for the ease of simplification. And if you are, say, treating or seeing 100 patients a month, you'll be doing many consultations in that only, which will not be converting. There will be procedures to be done. There will be some complaints also where you will not be charging, but just charging the bare minimum amount. So if you are doing 100 patients and grossing around 1 lakh, so there will be 20 patients who would have paid you around 80,000 rupees. And the remaining 80%, would have paid you 20,000 rupees. So the total says that your 20% of the effort is yielding you 80% of the results. and the remaining 20% income is coming from 80% of your patients. So the smart work says, in marketing language or practice management, if we speak, we have to identify those 20% potential candidates every month. Of course, that is a topic for a separate day altogether. So 80% of your profits come from your 20% of your patients. 80% complaints also come from 20% of your patients. So again, 80% profits come from 20% of the time you spend. And basically, this principle holds good in almost every industry and is universally applicable. Those who are doing record keeping, they may go and check. They may go back to their clinics tomorrow, Monday morning, and check out the same in their records. And they'll be surprised to find that this holds true for at least, say, 11 months in the year out of 12. Of course, discounting the COVID-19 months where we didn't earn at all, of course. So the value of the Pareto principle says that we have to focus on the 20% that matters. This one line is in the gist of everything. 20% that matters for your patients also, you have to identify those patients. 20% when you are, say, identifying your procedures also. So SmartWork says total activities you do during the day, the 20% of the same is the one that really matters. So because sometimes 20% of your efforts produce 80% of your results. So we have to learn to identify and focus on those things. So now let's come to deciding about the treatment charges part. So what is the common thing? Let's suppose we market and say project ourselves and we start having more footfall, or say we create COVID post COVID-19 awareness that yes, we are equipped with all the latest facilities and gadgets and we are ready to serve you without any fear or inhibitions in your, say, life. So you can leave your worries home and come to us for a safer and a decent experience. And you start having a footfall. This again has a two, say, prong theory, which has a different aspect to it. So when you start having a footfall, you obviously will allocate and spend less time. Again, defies the basic principle of practice, the first consultation. Unless you do a good first consultation, you spend time with the patient, you emphasize the patient's needs and wants, you are not going to get good conversions. So when you spend less time, you'll be either sacrificing or, say, cutting down on presenting the patient with the complete treatment plan options. And as I always say, patients are very smart these days. They always come prepared. They come prepared with their, say, Google research, or maybe they have already undergone a first opinion. So I always say to my colleagues that treat yourself as the third dentist of the patient. The first dentist may be the patient's original dentist if the patient is a new one, and the second is the Google dentist, or Dr. Google as we call it, because they are well read, well informed these days, and dentistry has especially come into limelight and focus. Especially with the government of India and MHFW come giving out guidelines only for dentistry. They never gave guidelines for any ENT, gynec, or any of the, say, medical specialties, but they did come out with it. So many of the guys said they were literally, say, troubled, if I may be allowed to use that word, troubled by the patients calling, please open up, please open up. Now that we have opened up, even for consultations, or yes, some of us are daredevils and we are started with the AGPs also. So irrespective of whether it is an emergency or not, but now the number of patients has drastically cut down because the awareness has spread that dentist is at the highest risk of contamination. So let's come back to our original topic, that we are allocating and spending less time with the patient, giving less treatment options, defeating the purpose of the first consultation, or we are, say, rushing the patient with the, say, huge amount of choices in a less time to think about it. So what will be the result? The patients will not actually turn up, if I may say so, a poor conversion ratio. This is also called as I mentioned, the inverse care law. A pun on that, there is a roller blading method of dentistry. Rural blading method is basically used in inline skating, in say skating, where it is presumed that you burn more calories while say doing a roller blading than actually doing other kinds of exercises. Again, it is a misnomer, just like the inverse Kerr law. If we are not in a say consumption industry, we are in a healthcare industry. Footfall does not always translate into more income. This is one aspect which we have to clearly understand. Believe me or not, I lecture all over India, but I find people fondly say gushing over the fact that we have a OPD of 35, 40, 45, 50. So I say, what is good about it? Is it a status symbol to have a OPD of 35 to 50? No dentist can treat 35 to 50. Even if having 5 chairs, even if having, say, multiple associates, you still can't treat 35 to 50 in a day. Yes, if you are doing in rushed procedures, then you might be able to. If you are just managing and just overlooking all your associates doing it, then still you might be. But then how many are such? Maybe a handful out of whole India. Overall, we are majority, 80 to 90% clinics, or maybe say slightly more, are single to double chair clinics in India, either single or double. If we combine the percentage of that is around 92% as per a very recent survey I read online. So around 91.8 or say roughly speaking, 92% of chairs in India, clinics, dental clinics in India are single or double digit. Of course, the remaining fall in the 3 to 7 to 10 digit, or they are in the hospital part or anything. So if we were to indulge in the roller blading method of dentistry, just to have a fake image of that, yes, we are treating more patients, then you are free to follow this formula. Otherwise, it again, like roller blading method, it may result in temporarily, say, higher burnout of calories. And you have a screenshot to say, look, see, I have burned this much more calories than you burning by walking or by brisk walking. So, but then it comes with a side effect also, with a risk factor also. It can lead to a nasty fall. It can break your ligament and can keep you bedridden for even 3 to 6 months. So short-term targets should never be looked at. It is always the longer picture which helps in life. So what are the side effects if you follow such kind of a method of, say, treating more? High overheads. Obviously, when you treat more, you'll be consuming more things. You'll be having more associates. You'll have lesser control over the, say, treatment regimens happening in your clinic. Then more treatment means more fatigue, poor health, and no time only. As I mentioned in the four habits, then you won't have, you will be cutting down on time somewhere. It can be your me time, leisure time. It can be your gym time, walk time. Obviously, if not any of these, then it is your family time. So if I talk in today's working, those who are not doing AGPs, we are actually, say, having more expenses these days by going to clinic for full duration and actually earning less. Just because it has not been, say, full month even for most of us. Many of colleagues who were falling lawfully, they resumed after the, say, the third lockdown, when the restrictions were lifted on 17th, 18th May. So they started after that only, most of us. They are sitting in the clinic. Some of them are sitting for 2 hours, some for four, some for six. And some have modified their schedule from 10 to 6. They are sitting in the clinics just because the curfew is till 8 or even till 7 also. So they are yet to arrive at a numbers of month end that how much they have actually burnt and how much they have actually earned. It is when they realize such figures, so they'll be coming to a conclusion that unless you are doing any procedures which don't fall in the emergency, say, field, emergencies, please keep it aside, which are not falling in the emergency, by going full-time to clinic, you're actually consuming more resources, more overheads. So that, please don't misunderstand me. That does not mean in any way that I'm stopping you all from going to clinic. What I'm trying to stress upon is, again, on the rollerblading method. Number of hours, if you keep on sitting from 10 to 7, in the weight of patients that a walk-in will happen, especially after so much awareness and the guidelines given by the MHFW as well, you are not going to serve the purpose in that manner. You're not going to earn much. Yes, you're going to consume more. Of course, do follow this method at the end of the month on 17th or 18th of June. You'll have your figures, how much you have spent actually and how much you have earned actually. And remember, deduct your bills also from that and deduct your, say, your overheads also, and then calculate what is your carry home. Definitely the revenue is going to fall, but definitely remember the costs have gone up also. You can segregate the cost part. We'll be dealing in the second part on next Sunday about the cost part, how to calculate that. Believe me, that'll be a very interesting session when you actually know where which are your biggest thieves of the clinic. So how to increase the charges? Let's come to the main point for which we are all here. It's almost half time of my presentation. And I'm coming to the main point right now, just by building up the base about it, that the main basis of this is from your record keeping. And the reason for this is you have to follow the 80-20 principle in this again. How? Let's see. So again, we have to first analyze which services are giving us 80% revenue, and then which are predominantly contributing to 80% of the revenue, those 20% of services. Why I say so? Because those services which are falling in 80% contributing income category, they will be just handful of services. Let's suppose your Crown and Bridge bills are 60% of your total collection. So, and add RCTs to that, 20%. So your majority income would be coming from root canal and Crown and Bridge, just for an example. So you have to calculate those things which are contributing 80% to your, and the remaining services, your consultation, your complaints, your dentures, your scalings, your restorations, whatever, they would be falling in the, say, 20% contribution category, in the 80% category, which are contributing 20% only to the income. Why I say so? Because you may be a periodontist, but your majority income would be coming from maybe Crown and Bridge only. So thus the start has to be from those minute or the basic levels. Remember, finance can be endless, but what we have tried to add in these four sessions of June is that we go only by the basics part and just educate everyone. These videos will be available after this session also on the UDS also, and on my YouTube channel also. I'll be giving you the links, so you can watch these videos again for a basic let's continue from a couple of slides back, so that if anybody of you has missed that portion, I'll be repeating it again. So the basic understanding is that we have to follow or adopt the 80-20 principle for increasing our charges also. We have to analyze where actually our income, or say 80% income of the clinic, comes from. As I mentioned, let's suppose for the ease of simplification that you are grossing, or say total collection of your clinic, not the net income, but the total over the counter or the over the table collection of the month is 1 lakh, and you're treating 100 patients in a month, or taking charges from 100 patients in a month, you'll be, say, assumed to find that 80% or 80,000 of that 1 lakh will be coming from around 20 patients in that month. And the remaining 20,000 will be coming from 80 patients out of those 100. So it is the 20% services, as I said, which play a role. And we have to look at those services which are actually important to us and which play a role in our clinic. It is no point in increasing charges of those services which are hardly contributing to the clinic revenue. And when I talk of the figures, of the month figures, we always have to take the yearly figures into account on a broad base, not only as a single month. There might be isolated months. For example, I do very less of dentures by luck only. It's not by that. But sometimes I have had those months where I had 6 dentures in a month, then no denture for the next 4 months. So roughly that splits out, or divides my average of dentures again to 1 per month only, which is the normal average. So we have to look at the yearly figures and not at that this month, let's suppose, again, I'm talking of the pre-COVID times. For the expenses part, we have to look at pre-COVID times. Our expenses are not going to reduce. Our rents, if on rent and not your own clinic, our rents, our bills, our salaries, say all of them are going to be the same. The only difference would be the materials and the lab part, which are anyways dependent on the patient. If you have more patients, more material would be consumed. And if you have more lab work, obviously the lab bill would be comparatively or say proportionately more. So the other three overheads would remain the same. So we have to look at those figures which are say contributing handsomely and not in a handful manner to your clinic. Handsomely means the figure, the amount is a good one, and handful means the number of services which will be the less one, but they'll be contributing more. So why I said so, because you may be a periodontist, but your major income might be coming from crown bridge in your practice. And it is just a matter of chance sometimes. So the start has to be from the basic or the minute levels. You have to understand your numbers. Where is your figure going to come from? Say exorbitantly increasing all your treatment charges is going to send only a wrong message to your say targeted group. So let's, as I said, go back to your record keeping and check your yearly figures of cost, not your monthly figures. Add up your new costs. I have arrived at a figure after my say style of calculations that my overall costs are going to increase by 25%. And what I was telling just before the technical glitch happened, that I have taken the cost of consumables in this plus the depreciation cost or the say written down value cost of the equipment, which is roughly 15% of that equipment. I've not calculated the full equipment because that is my fixed asset and that is going to be worn off in 7 to 8 to 10 years going by the depreciation standards. So I'm going to add those costs. So let's suppose I have a figure that my costs are going to increase by 25%. So what should be my proportionate increase in my practice, considering I have the same revenue, considering I have say 75% revenue with a 25% drop, or two-third or a 50%. And all of these are good likely possibilities for the next 2 months, for sure. Even after when we resume the AGPs, these figures I'm talking after we resume the AGPs, not in the consultation period. Of course, in the consultation period, we are just dealing with the emergency part only, and we are not doing the full procedure. So we cannot expect to have a comparative income analysis with those months. So how do we decide the raise? Do we make a raise in all services of the clinic? My answer for this, again, you're free to differ in your approach. But again, as my aim is to say simplify things for you on all four Sundays of June in terms of charges, expenses, and the other financial matters. So my answer would be a say big no in this. Why do I say so? Because it is an age of say smartness, and we ought to exert some smartness in our lives also, in our way of working also. So what I believe is that do not raise all your services. Do not raise the charges of all your services, but only those 20% which are contributing to 80% revenue. Do not raise means just the proportional or the annual increase will be there. If you have not done that in the January this year, I increase my charges every year by 10 to 15% or whatever formula I follow for different specific options, depending upon consumption in the month of January only. If you have not increased your annual charges for that, increase by 25 to 30 in your 80% contribution categories. Means only a few of your services, those 20% of services who are giving 80% revenue, you are going to increase 25 to 30% in that. And the annual usual increase, if you have not done in this January, 10 to 15% in those 20% contribution category, so that your average profit increase is still up to 25%. How? Let's see that. Because if we calculate it in that way, if we take the average of 25 to 30, it is 27.5%. And if we take the average of 10 to 15, it is 12 to 5%. So if we take, say, the proportion of that means the contributory effect of 27.5% on the 80% of services, it comes roughly to that figure that if we add both of them, that answer would be in the range of 24.5. So which roughly means the overall increase would be close to 25% only. I'll be showing this better in the example scenarios so that these things are more clear to you in the coming slides. So why? Because if you increase everything by 25 to 30%, remember it is going to send a very wrong message to your target group. And considering the fact that the purchase power of the consumer or the patient is also going to go down. But the rosy side is that if somebody didn't take a cab in the month of April, or somebody didn't go to a Domino or a McDonald's or a Cafe Coffee Day, that revenue is lost forever. But in our case, the caries didn't stop. Rather, it was more in those months because of the amount of junk people ate and the wisdom tooth haven't, say, straightened up themselves, or other problems have not disappeared themselves. So our revenue might have been a bit delayed, but yes, it is not over at all. So we are supposed to act smart and not increase, say, 25 to 30%, whatever is the intended one in all of our services. Let's demonstrate these via a few scenarios. I'll give you a scenario via, say, I am assuming the over-the-top collection of the month at 1 lakh rupees. Let's suppose the monthly collection or the gross figure is 1 lakh. And overall expenses are usually in the range of 50%. It may be 40, it may be 60, but for the ease of simplification and on the average side speaking, I've taken the figure to be 50%. So your carry-home income is also in the range of 50% then? So what do you mean? If you're grossing 1 lakh, you're approximately carrying home a net amount of 50,000 rupees a month. Is it clear? Now, let's assume your enhanced, say, costing is in the 25% increase. As I said, whatever way I have calculated, it is going to give you an average increase of 25%. Of course, this will again vary, number one, depending upon the size of the clinic. Number two, depending upon the dentist's eagerness to, say, inculcate all the changes and all the desired guidelines in the practice. But I don't see anyone, say, easily escaping those hands of law because there will be definitely checks by the health department if the guidelines come from the government side, and we have to do that. So let's assume the expenses are in the range of 25% increase, as we have kept the figure at in the beginning. So the 25% of 50,000 is roughly 12,500. So total expenses, as we said, it were 50,000. Now they add this sum to the initial figure. Your total expenses are 62,500. So if you don't increase your charges, your carry home income would be down to 75%. A fall of 25% in that. If you subtract 1,000 minus 62,500, the answer would be 37,500. A shortfall of 12,500. As I said, those who don't increase their charges, they will be deducting this amount from their carry home amount. The carry home amount was 50,000. So the increasing the cost becomes imperative. So this is a scenario when we say revenue is being generated in a similar manner, which is highly unlikely. So let's take a scenario two where we presume that the monthly collection or the gross collection falls by 25%, which is a very highly likely possibility. So if your revenue, the gross revenue which you are assuming at 1 lakh falls to 75,000, let's assume your expenses still remain in the 50% side. Of course, as I'll be detailing in later on, there are a few fixed expenses and a few variable expenses, but I'm not going to go into the intricacies of those today. I'm just, for the ease of simplification, going to tell you why increasing your charges becomes imperative because of this COVID-19 crisis. So if your costing, say, also decreases proportionately, your, say, expenses or overhead will come down to 50%, the figure would be 37,500, on the half of this figure. So if you add your 25% increase on that, 25% increase on this amount, as we did in the scenario one on this amount. So now our clinic expense for a month presumed is based on our 25% fall, say increase of 25% would be 9375. I've rounded it off to 9500 for the ease of calculation. So our total expenses, 37500 plus 95 become 47,000. So remember, our revenue was also down by 25 and it was 75,000. So what we see is that our carry home amount is 28,000 now. So just with a 25% fall in your income, if you don't raise your charges, your carry home will reduce by 44%. And remember, I have taken the expenses proportionate to your income, wherein in actuality, your expenses might be 50,000 only. I just reduced it for the ease of simplification. So what does that mean? It'll further reduce your carry home income if you don't raise your charges. Let me give you a scenario three. If you have a fall of 33%, which is again a possibility when we say resume our clinics full on. Remember, also comes in the light of the fact that we will be treating effectively less patients. We'll be keeping a gap of, say, half an hour between our appointments. We'll be keeping following the social distancing in our practice. Yesterday only, I was reading an article that social distancing may be compulsory by 2022. It might be compulsory for the next 2 years. You never know. So let's assume the collection falls by 33%. So now the revenue, which we had presumed at 1 lakh, falls to, again, 66,500. So I've just rounded it off to 67,000 for the ease of calculation. Again, 50% of this, the clinic expenses, again, I've reduced proportionately. As I said, in actuality, they might not. In actuality, they might be the original figure of 50,000 only. So let's suppose they fall down as well. Do some cost cutting. Maybe we have three staff members. We give a layoff to one staff member and our proportional expenses decrease. So the figure now is 33,500. Apply the 25% increase, which we have, say, which we are bound to have, which we are usually bound to have in our practice. So again, we arrive at this figure of 8375. I have rounded it off to 8500 for the ease of calculation. So add 33,500 and 8500, you have a 42,000. Now subtract this from your revenue. 67 minus 42, you arrive at a figure of 25,000. So if your revenue falls by 33%, your carry home will reduce by 50%. Remember, we have to understand that our carry home expenses, which cover all our needs, wants, our kids' expenses, our own expenses, our home expenses, our home bills, they are all paid from this figure. Remember this part. So you have to concentrate on this figure. What are you carrying home actually? So it becomes very imperative for us to understand in that regard. So let me take up the gravest scenario, which might be a remote possibility, but not exactly unlikely, that our revenue falls by 50%. Our revenue is down from 1 lakh to 50,000. And let's suppose our expenses also decrease to 50%. Again, as I said, we have to assume that they go in sync with that. In actuality, they are always more. Because if I place the actual figures here, they are bound to give a heart attack to a few of you. So I don't want that. So just for the ease of simplification, add 25% to that. So you arrive at a figure of 6250, again, rounded off for the ease of calculation. Add in your expenses on the last slide, as I had 25,000. And now you arrive at a figure of 31,500. So the carry home comes down from 50,000 to a meager 18,500. Remember the Hindi muhavra, nanga nahayega kya, nichodega kya. If you have a 50% fall in your income with 25% increase in your cost, your carry home is going to reduce by 63%.
only carry home will be 37%, which is peanuts. Which is peanuts. Actually, you cannot run your home in this kind of expenses. That is where the hatred towards dentistry starts developing, that dentistry is not paying us. We forget that the fault lies at our end. We did not raise the charges as they were expected to be. So what is the solution? Mr. India film aayi thi 1987 mein Anil Kapoor ki. Mr. India formula, wo, obviously some of you or most of you must have seen that movie, but that was a watch which Anil Kapoor was carrying to say disappear to be invisible. The late Mr. Amrish Puri used to call it wo formula mujhe de do. So I'm going to give you that formula for Mr. Indian or Mr. India dentist. What is that? You have to increase via Pareto principle. As I said, 25 to 30, the average is 27.5%. If you take 27.5% of 80%, we have to take proportionate percentage, the output which will be contributing to the raise would be 22% actually, because it is not from the 100 for the whole revenue, only for the 80% of the paying services. So the contribution will be 22% only. Let's see the other raise. As I said, treat the other services as the annual, say, raise of 10 to 15%, average 12 to 5%. So the 20% contribution of that 12.5 would be 2.5 only. So this is the difference. Even if you increase 15% on that, the same would be maximum up to 3%. So I have taken the average 12.5. So the output or the contribution of the same would be 2.5. So if you add the 22 plus 2.5, it'll be close to say 24.5 or close to the 25% desired increase in revenue. See, by following the Pareto principle, we are say actually having close to 25% increase as we wanted. But what is it has actually done is, let's suppose we are offering 20 services in our practice. Out of that, only two or three are contributing to 80%. So we have just increased by one, say 25 to 30% of those three services only. The remaining 17% are on the normal side, 10%, 12%. So which are contributing just this much amount. And remember, many of us bought many things of FMCG on say MRP or even above MRP because it was our need. And remember, healthcare is always and will always be a need for most of us. So remember this, just by doing a smart calculation, you are still adding 25% to the increase in the revenue, which is actually desired. Now what it does, I'll take up in the coming slides. So first of all, let's apply the formula to all the four situations which I have discussed before. So scenario five means the similar to the scenario one, your say your income does not fall at all. Your collection remains as 1 lakh. And if we increase the charges by a formula of 25.5%, or say I'll apply to for ease of simplification again, the 25%, your revenue becomes 1,25,000. So overhead is again 50% of the original amount, 50,000. Added figure of again 62,500 as we did. So our carry home would be 125 minus 62, 62,500. So if our revenue generated is same, with this smart approach, we'll be carrying home increased by 25%. We were carrying home 50,000 per month to our home. But now, even after our raise applied, or raise means whatever increased cost we are incurring on our on our expenses of, due to COVID-19 crisis, we are still carrying home by 25% plus. What all would you want? And remember, in this, I have increased the cost of only three services out of the 20 you're offering. The rest 17 have increased just by a nominal amount. So there will be many questions when we ask, should I increase consultation or not? Should I increase in that? I told you those figures which fall in the 20% category and contributing to 80% revenue, those only should be increased by this good figure of 25 to 30 or 27.5%. So let's take the scenario two, where we had a revenue fall of 25%. We expected that our gross collection reduced from 1 lakh to 75,000. Now we increase our charges of 24.5% to our revenue, and we arrive at this figure that we have increased our charges and we are getting rounded out of 94,000. This revenue courtesy our increased charges. So our expenses would be 37,500. And even after an additional increase of 25%, I'll be getting a figure of 47 as we saw in the scenario two before. So what is our carry home amount? Our carry home amount is 47,000. So just imagine with the 25% fall in your total collection, but with a selective raise in charges out of just maybe two or three services out of 20 you're offering, your carry home amount is reducing just by 6% or just by 3,000 rupees only. And 25% fall is very likely in coming scenarios. If you increase your revenue, say selectively, as I mentioned, your carry home will not reduce even if your income falls by 25%. Let's take up the third scenario, or the scenario seven. Your income falls by 33%. I've not taken the detailed calculations in this, but if we have a 33% fall in income, even then our carry home will reduce by just by 16%. The exact answer to this would be 42,000. What I have calculated on the detailed sheet, your carry home would be 42,000. That means just a fall of 8,000 rupees or just 16% fall. Similarly, if your revenue falls, God forbid, by 50%, then your carry home would come down to roughly 31,000, which is a fall of 38%. So even with a 50% fall in income, but selectively increasing your charges, your carry home will reduce just by 38%. You will still have 31,000 to carry home against the earlier 50,000. So remember, you have to think on those lines. Now, what this does is actually, basically, if we increase all our services, so it is going to send a wrong message to our target group that we have hiked our charges exorbitantly. And we are offering, seeing is believing, as I say. So when we show that we are following the strictest guidelines and there is a value addition in the, say, services or in the, say, system being offered to the patient, so patients will understand. All that comes at a price escalation. That is why I said those services, that is why where I started with the example of a single restoration. Calculate how many restorations you are doing in a month or in a year. How much are they contributing to the total revenue? And accordingly, you can decide upon whether they are going to fall in that category or not. Again, this comes irrespective of whether you are using six-handed dentistry or your two assistants are helping you out along with you using 3 PPE suits and face shields and N95s. And don't cost the cost in those terms, because we have taken the total figure overall. That is where the importance of database comes in. And again, there is a very old adage in marketing which is used: if you can't convince them, confuse them. Obviously, it doesn't mean that you confuse them. It is basically just applying smartness in your trade. And this is knowing your art and knowing your numbers pretty well. From where I started my first line, you should be knowing your numbers pretty well in your So what are a few problems? The problem is, there are a few assumptions which I have made, which might be coming to the minds of a few of you as I end this presentation. So the baseline of the above system is that record keeping, you have to gather the data from your record keeping and from further segregate where those 80% or those 20% figures come from. So it is actually mandatory by the DCI also to maintain your record since the revised guidelines came in 2014, 6 years back. So still many colleagues are not indulging in that. Even those who are indulging are totally software dependent, do not have a actual segregation or say the division of the numbers they ought to keep. Remember, this becomes absolutely mandatory in today's times. So still a ray of hope. Small clinics, most of the small clinics have a good chunk of revenue, 60, 70, 80% revenue coming from their lab bills. So they know that what is the contributory factor. So usually they have their kacha lab bill or the, because they want to save the GST on that also. So they are saving on those parts. So at least they have the kacha lab bills, which can be used for calculation of the same. So again, the catch, as I mentioned earlier also, the assumed expenses have been 50% average, whereas in actuality, they might be 30 to 40 or 60 to 70 as well, depending upon the size of the clinic or the amount of facilities you are offering to your patients. Then I have kept the average carry home expense, the carry home amount at 50,000 and made the calculations of increase or decreasing assumptions accordingly. So, which might not be even an actuality, but with every say percentage fall in revenue, I have proportionately reduced the expenses overhead. As I said, mentioned before also, in actuality, the figure may be more. So the results may be say a lot more skewed in terms of revenue. The revenue, carry home revenue will be actually less. So as I said before also, it might give a heart attack to a few. So I don't want to indulge in that. I've just kept it simplified so that you know actually that how increasing the charges becomes mandatory and how you do have to do it smartly. I mentioned in the whole video, those who have joined later, maybe they can watch the video later on. So my aim is just to give you a roadmap. Everybody has different numbers, different the rosy side is that I've taken the figures on the higher side, the gross figures of 1 lakh are on the higher side, and about 60 to 70% of the dentists fall in that category. Their expenses will be at the say less than 50%. Their carry home might be actually 60%, 60,000 or so out of that 1 lakh, maybe even up to 70 also. The smaller clinics have comparatively smaller charges or smaller overheads because they are usually working with one staff member. And as I can envisage the scenario, having two assistants becomes mandatory even for those small clinics as well. One inside your operatory and one in your waiting area for the triage purpose, or say guiding the patient or the walk-in patient, or even your appointed patient for that purpose. So, and both of them should know their trait well so that the duties can be interchanged sometimes. And also if some one of them misses out or has a leave because of any reason, any emergency, so then either of them should be aware of the task done by the other. So of course that will not be a daily situation, but as I can see is the two assistant or the increased overhead or increased expense would be a reality for even smaller clinics as well, those who have been working with only one assistant. So the precautions and treatment charges, we'll have to shun the Facebook dentistry approach, the FOMO approach as we call it, the fear of missing out. So all the bargain buys will have to be eliminated, that I get 1+1 free or 2+1 free. Check out whether you actually need it or not. So look at your consumption pattern or the same medical buying pattern. So things you can or must have been buying in exponents in the garb of getting a good discount or say good but due to lack of consumption, they ended up being expired. As I said, I'll be dealing with the biggest thieves of dental practice, consumption-wise or material-wise, in the next session on Sunday on 14th of June. So we'll have to re-estimate our post-COVID-19 era demands of the clinic, especially material-wise, so that our inventory can be curtailed a lot and we don't just follow people on Facebook and get fascinated by the gadgets they use. We have to be very realistic. If we have to use the Pareto principle in the charges part, we have to understand this part also, that those treatments which are not falling in the category of 80% or they say don't contribute to the 80% revenue categories, they have to be say strictly restricted for in terms of purchase. Remember this thing. This will become a very important part in the say coming times. So will there be any newer equipment needs? A fumigator or a HEPA filter or a fogging machine or a negative ion generator? Where does the buck finally settle on? Only time will tell. Why do I say so? Because I said at the start also, if the guidelines don't come in written from the government side or the ministry side, you are not supposed to indulge in such kind of buying of heavy equipment. Because if you buy it and the guidelines come later on, because since they have mentioned the guidelines before, they'll be coming out with, as we hear that the Niti Aayog is coming to come with those very soon. And many of the prominent people are on the panel of the Niti Aayog for that purpose. So if they come out with that, they'll be giving out certain amount of specifications. You may have bought certain filters which might not be actually fitting into that range. Or maybe the equipment which you might not be actually needing. And 6 months down the line, those equipments will be staring at you, that you wasted or blocked your money at them. So remember, when the specifications comes, the supply and the demand chain starts, and a price tag will also be there from the government side as well. So remember, PPE kits started from 700. Now they're available for 250. Of course, the GSM varies, the taping varies, the design varies. But did the 700 ones you bought in the month of April, out of fear or insecurity, comply with all the norms? Were the CITRA approved? In those days, say, people were getting a CITRA certificate for just about 10 to 15,000 only. So how do you know, actually, that those bought at 700 complied with the guidelines, and those being available at 250 today are not doing so? So you have to be smart. Don't say, get into the herd mentality that everyone is buying, so I have to buy. I have not bought any of these gadgets except the HEPA filter, which I already have. I bought an Atmosphere Mini M-Way filter in the month of October near Diwali. Since close relation of mine is an M-Way business, so they got me a good deal in that. At that time, construction was going on in my premises of clinic, so I didn't unpack it, and it is still lying packed in my premises. Of course, I'll have to, still the construction part is not yet over in my clinic. The paint and slight other portions are pending, but maybe I postponed it to a later then end. But then if I was not having those filters, I'm not going to buy them unless or until I get an advisory or a written guideline from the government that yes, this is mandatory for your setup. Why do we need to follow the mentality in that? Yes, other sanitization things are definitely important. But for the others, I'll prefer always to wait. So inventory control will always require more importance in times to come. Unless you have money to throw away, you can buy all of them and add a disco fogger also to that. So that will be more catchy to that. So unless the above is done, the balance sheet will continue to bleed. As they say, will appear in red or in the red zone or in the negative zone. That means you will be continue to trade losses in your say balance sheet of the clinic. You'll carry home less, you'll incur more. So the complaint will still remain from the dentistry in those matters. We shall discuss overheads on next Sunday in that. So I'll be giving you some carry home gyan, as I've done earlier also. Most of us are self-employed. Even those who are salaried in colleges and running clinics do not have a pension. So no one wants to die early. So we should charge well, earn well, and all strive to retire early. Believe me, it is very difficult to ask for money from kids. And it is indeed a sorrowful old life laden or ridden with the health problems. So self-dependence is the biggest gift we can give to ourselves. Think about it. Because this is the carry home amount will also decide your retirement corpus. The amount you will be investing for your retirement will come from that carry home amount only. How these things are cross linked with each other, unless you increase your charges, you are going to carry home a lesser amount. And obviously, if your expenses of the home remain the same, the bills are not going to shorten, the kids are not going to be taken off from the school, your basic necessities are not going to be cut off drastically, your car petrol, your other things. The only thing you can cut off is maybe on your vacation part, maybe on your say leisure part, but again that is a different story altogether. So you have to remember, if you don't increase your charges, you'll carry home less. If you follow the rollerblading method, as I've told earlier, you will be continuing to burn or break your back and neck. So thank you for your presentation. I'll be going to stop sharing the screen, and I have a couple of announcements after that. Once I'm done with the queries, I'll be again sharing the screen for that purpose. All yours, Dr. Girish. We are all set to take the queries.
Thank you so much, sir, for the presentation and the guidance. I'll be definitely looking for the disco fogger for sure. We have a couple of questions. There was one question somebody was asking, how you convince the patient or justify your increased charges in this COVID scenario. When people say that they have lost their jobs and not earning much, and doctors in difficult times, instead of serving, are trying to make money out of it. So I guess this is, we usually hear from the patient that in times like these, doctors are making, minting money out of us, out of the patient. So that is the basic argument that we'll be hearing from each and everyone. So what's your take on this?
As I mentioned, the value addition has to be there. If the patient sees that you're working with precautions, your say surroundings have changed. As I mentioned, for smaller clinics, that doesn't have to be by the government guidelines. That is just pure common sense. If the patient sees the doctor earlier had one assistant, now he's having two. Both of them are decked up in a certain kind of a uniform, certain kind of a precaution or a guiding, protective equipment. And the value addition is there in form of various services. So definitely the charges would be justifiable. But again, healthcare is not a commodity line like FMCG that patients will indulge in bargain. If they see the value, they'll definitely not mind paying more. And having said that, the formula, as I mentioned, comes into play equally, because if you increase the services of everything, so that becomes, it sends across a wrong message to the patient that he's become exorbitant or he's minting money, as you said. But if you do it smartly and you do only in the few services, and if you tell it priorly or beforehand to the patient and let the patient decide, if the patient chooses to walk away, it's his choice. But then there will be only a handful of people who will be working at the old charges. But yes, there will be many who will be working with enhanced charges. But if you apply this smartness, you'll be sending across a reasonably good message that yes, his charges may be increased in a few services, but not in all of the services.
So, okay, the communication is the major.
Communication is absolutely paramount. And having said that, as I mentioned very clearly, if you are not, if you're having a lot of consultations and they're contributing to your 80% revenue, yes, you can do that. You can go on increasing that. But otherwise, if you're charging 200, you can maybe increase, say, 10 to 12% or 15%, as I said, rounding it off, maybe you can keep it 250. So that is understandable. So if you make it 200 to 400, that will be a different thing. Again, you have to think rationally. As I said, in the restoration example of 1000 charges, that you don't have to calculate then that those two PPE kit cost into that, because you will be covering up the cost there, that cost from some other treatment modality, which is already being done in abundance in your clinic. The Pareto principle says this thing. You have to cover from those which you're doing in abundance, and covering the trivial charges from the ones which are doing in triple quantity or less quantities.
All right. Okay. There was one more question. Right. Is there a limit to how much money must be invested back into the clinic for improvement, and how to track the increase in the overhead expenses in this in today's scenario?
See, what was the first part? Please repeat.
Is there a limit to how much money we must invest back into the clinic for improvement?
Facebook has made it sure that there is no limit to such thing. I mentioned there is a FOMO approach going on. So we have to limit ourselves. Inventory control is going to play a major role in cutting down your overheads. And tracking the way is only by a proper material management or ordering in a economic order quantity, which we'll be taking up in the next session. How to limit your inventory, how to say manage your material, how to manage your needs. Obviously, it is not easy that I have, let's suppose we are calculating on the term of, in the terms of a composite or a glass hammer that I have used about 2 grams of glass hammer in this patient and 1 gram of a composite in this patient. This is not practically possible. But then you ought to keep a say calculative analysis that you ordered a kit for this amount and how many restorations do did out of that kit. So that is for you to see. But if you go on ordering new kits when the past even kit hasn't say vanished by 50% or say been consumed by 50%, and you ordered a new kit just in the hope that you are getting a good deal, and ultimately half of the material ended up being expired, so you are eventually in a loss. So you have to calculate right from those ends also. As I mentioned, there are two biggest thieves in your clinic, the wastage and the expired material. Wasted by the assistants in say terms of say overmixing sometimes, and say the expired composites or cements or whatever, any material consumables. These are the two biggest thieves, which we'll be discussing in detail in the overhead section in the next session on Sunday.
Right. All right. And there was one more question about inventory management. I think that will be covering on 14 June.
Yeah.
And most of the questions were already answered through the presentation. So I think we are done for today. And guys, we'll be having 3 more days. On the 14th of June, we'll be having financial record keeping and inventory management. So stay tuned. We'll be back shortly. I'll update.
I have to share a screen for a few announcements.
Sure. Please go ahead, sir. Please.
Sure. Okay. So thank you, Underdog Dentist Squad, Dr. Girish, Dr. Weber, for giving me this opportunity on all 4 Sundays of June. It is a pleasure sharing whatever little I know about finances with my colleagues and giving back to the profession. So a couple of announcements. So this is my website. This is my say social media links. You can say catch me on there. So you can get me in touch through email, through phone number anyways. So I write a finance article series also. So a quarterly series in the Punjab State Journal and in the World Journal of Advanced Scientific Research, in which 16 parts have been published already. So all of them are available on my website and on the below given link. So you can get through those links and get benefited through those articles. Most of you are already knowing because I've shared it already on Facebook. Say apart from that, I'm running a few WhatsApp groups on practice management and finance. Practice management, all the 5 groups are full. Finance, a few slots are vacant. If you want, you can contact me on the number. I'll add you to the group. Those are totally ad-free groups, and it is my way of giving back to the society, and totally ad-free. And even my own workshops are not shared over there. So I have a YouTube channel also, and this video also will be put up soon on there, as soon as I get a link from Dr. Girish. So if you forget to YouTube, it is in my name only, again, Dr. Bhavdeep. By channel, Dr. Bhavdeep. If you forget, go to YouTube and search for Dr. Bhavdeep Pooja, hit the bell icon, because I'll be posting 1 or 2 videos every week from now on. So that's it. Thank you so much for your kind attention and patience in there. So I'm done from my side, Dr. Girish. Thank you so much to both of you. Dr. Vaibhav is in the background and Dr. Girish in the front managing the show. Obviously, even their endeavor is to give back to the community as much as they can through their wonderful group, the UDS, the Underdog Dentist Squad. So all yours, Dr. Girish.
Definitely, sir. Thank you so much for today's session. All right, guys. Have a great evening and goodbye.
Thank you.